Yeah, so my name is Ravi Kiran. I'm here because usually I talk. I talk so much, right, that sometimes I get bored listening to myself. No, honestly, so I became an entrepreneur. Probably I've been an entrepreneur far shorter than many of you have been, right? So which is about less than 2 years. So I did 20 years of corporate slavery, if you call it that, in two different advertising companies. I got an opportunity to run geographies, functions, build a company, you know, in different parts of the world as well as here in India. In 2011 January, I got out, opted out actually. Maybe about 5 or 6 months before I would have certainly got bored. So I was not bored yet, but I didn't want to see that day until I get bored and just don't want to go to office. Right? Happens to many of us. So I realized over the last 14 months, I have set up two companies. One works with startups called Venture Nursery. It's a startup accelerator based in Bombay. And the other one is a growth stage consulting company. So basically, one burns money, the other one makes. So that hopefully over time I neutralize. But the first company, the second company is called Friends of Ambition. It deals with growth stage companies based in a geography we call Middle India, which is tier 2, tier 3 towns. So if a company has got 20, 30 crores and now wants to go to, you know, 100, 200, 300 over a short period, we go in and, you know, do what is required to scale the company. So that's why they pay us. Startups never pay us, right? So we sometimes we pay them. Right? So, but it's good to be here. Like Sarapna said, I've been out of the Thai universe for far too long. So I got in only about 2 months ago. Shortly before the big Bombay event, test. And this is my first introduction with Thai members. The only one before that I interacted is with, including me, three or other people. Right. So that's really about me. So I'm not sure I've read this book called The Argumentative Indian. Heard of it?
Yeah.
Who wrote it? Amartya Sen, right? So I read 8 pages. And I was so, you know, enthusiastic with 8 pages, I never gonna read beyond, right? It's a fantastic book. I think it's one of his earliest books and so on, right? And one of the things he says in the 8 pages is that people often discuss that how can India be such a large country and yet democratic? China is such a large country and yet survive because they're not democratic, right? By definition, large countries are not supposed to be democratic. Right? Because there are too much to be ruled and all that. And he says, actually, if you think about it, we have no option but to be democratic. Because we're always debating, right? We're always arguing. And so debate to us is not a process to go somewhere. Debate is our goal. So when you see Addas in Calcutta or Chaurahas in villages or Karam sessions in Bombay, those Karam and Addas, just, you know, they're just props. A real thing is how to debate. You know, what George Bush should have done in Iraq, or what Obama should do for the, you know, healthcare, you know, or what...
Why Sehwag should not have been dropped.
Sorry?
Or why Sehwag should not have been dropped.
Yeah, for example, that is the... That you don't even need carom board for that.
Everything except what you are supposed to
do. Right. So we... So, the reason I'm saying that is that this is likely to be like that. I hope, if I'm successful, we'll debate. If I'm not successful, you will go away saying thank you, very, very nice meeting you. So how many of you have ever been to tuition? No, no, you have to raise hand, guys. Some people are not gone. So when you go to tuition, who pays? The student or the teacher?
Student.
Who's paying for this session?
The teacher.
Teacher.
No. Therefore the student. One of these is the? So I'm here to learn, not to give can, not to only tell you from a pedestal. I'm standing because it's easier to learn when you're standing. Right? Right in the back bench you stand, no?
Huh?
Seriously, I think the interaction we'll have over the next 40 minutes, my guess will teach me more than it will teach you. Because in the last 5-6 days, ever since we chose this topic, which I thought would be reasonably provocative, I've done some googling research, I've read up stuff, I've dug into my past and picked up some experiences, right? Partly because we didn't want to make this a very non-provocative, non-evocative chai samosa and go kind of gambling, right? So we'll have interaction, and that's the way we're going to run this. Like, usually I talk with presentations, and man, presentations are like my mother, and we are inseparable. Everywhere I'm going and making presentations, right? And like, you take me out of presentations and I have serious self-doubt, identity crisis, who am I, why do I exist? So today,
so we managed to,
yeah, I don't have a presentation, right? But what I've done is I've scribbled some notes which I'm going to dig into once in a while to share with you my experiences, understand yours, right? So how many of you know the topic by word for word? Can anybody what's the topic of this discussion? Word for word.
Huh?
No, you can't. Anybody?
What is this better than success or failure?
You forgot the hyphen.
Failure versus failure.
Yeah, that's a good success or failure. But you forgot the hyphen, huh? No. So there are what teaches better, hyphen, success or failure or success? 7 words.
And then the exclamation mark.
Then exclamation? That must be her contribution. I didn't put exclamation mark. Usually it should have been a question mark.
Question mark. Yeah.
So let's say 8 characters, including 8 words, including question mark. Okay. I have just think for a second. Those, particularly those who are not come here only for networking. Because for them, how can I ask you if you have come only for networking? But whatever else, if you have come to interact. Which one of those words do you think we're going to discuss during the next 35, 40 minutes?
Failure.
Failure, raise hand. Anything else? Anybody for question mark? Hyphen? Sorry? Which word?
What?
What? What? Okay. No, you can say that. Okay. And what? One person, one word.
Okay.
Who else thinks any other word?
Learning.
There's no learning there.
Teachers.
Teachers. Okay. The reverse of learning, right?
Better.
No. So how many learning? Learning raise your hand. How many thought learning? Did you say that?
Yeah.
Two of you? Okay. Then you said better.
Yeah.
How many things we'll discuss better? Raise hand.
Two.
Three. So failure, followed by now better, followed by learning. Anything else? We will discuss or hyphen question mark? No. So let's start with failure. Right? Dig into whatever you have heard about failure and give me some famous quotes that other people have said about failure.
Failure is a stepping stone.
Failure is a stepping stone to success. I'm not going to write that. I think we'll all remember this. Very good. What else? One failure or multiple failures? What do you think that sentence is? Failures or failure? One.
Failures.
Maybe
it's
one.
Failures are milestones of success.
Not stepping stone, but milestones of success. So unless you have, like, I've reached Khopoli, I can't reach Pune. Got it. I'm just checking that. I don't have, right now I don't have a point of view. As we grow, I'll create my point of view. It's good. It's a good teacher. I've noticed some teachers, they don't come prepared. They just create something out of I'll prepare.
If you haven't failed big, you've not attempted big.
You've not failed big, you've not attempted big. Excellent. Who said that? You wrote it? You heard it somewhere?
I
don't remember.
What
have you heard
about? I didn't fail so many times, I just found so many ways of not knowing it right.
Sorry.
Edison said it?
Who said Edison? How much was Edison?
10,000.
What did he say?
I didn't fail 10,000 times. I mean, the essence was I didn't fail so many times, I just found so many ways of not doing it.
God. So he said, I did not fail so many times. So he was giving a counter to other people's view that he may have failed. Very good. He's the guy, I think, who invented the most number of devices and all, right? Or some inventions. Anything else? What have you heard about failure?
Famous.
Particularly if you can think of some famous people who have said things. One famous man said, famous bottle statement, right? There you go. R. Kage Ji, right there. So you see, very similar, right? After a failure lies success.
Something similar, NO means next opportunity.
Sorry?
NO
means next opportunity. Right. And NO being a symbol of failure.
Yeah.
Right, good.
My mentor used to say there is nothing as failure.
There is nothing?
The failure doesn't exist.
Doesn't exist. That's very famous. Your mentor?
My mentor.
Your mentor said that. Anybody else? Surely you would have heard a lot of things about failure.
Failing forward.
Huh?
Failing forward.
Failing forward. Fail. If you have to fail, fail forward, right? Popular as by Google and many others.
Encourage failure, reward failure.
Yeah?
Encourage failure, reward failure.
Reward failure, encourage failure. Embrace failure?
Embrace failure.
Embrace failure.
I thought I heard embarrass failure.
So I also read up quite a bit of famous sayings. So there's a site called Brainy Quote where I go if I'm in desperate need of some quotes which everybody has heard. So when I say those quotes, nobody says, okay, carry on. So one of those quotes is from Bill Gates, and he says, success is a lousy teacher. It seduces smart people into thinking they can't lose. Right? So you could have said the reverse for failure, that failure is a great teacher. I have to reverse the other thing. It says, you cannot seduce smart people into thinking they can lose. Something like that, right? And then I've got many other, Colin Powell said something, and many, many famous scientists have said something. You heard all these things about failure, right? Mm. How many of those guys who said that are failure themselves? Do you think? Did you know? Like, about you, we don't know yet. You said I failed, wrote this, right? But someday you'll write it, then we'll say it.
I hope I get
it. When did you hear the phrase and just begin to your past, your student life, family, college life, working life? That failure is a great teacher. Roughly.
Never.
When you were?
As a student, I think it was never said.
You were?
As a student, it was never said.
Okay, as a student, you never heard that. Oh, you are so protected from the rest of us. Okay, anybody? Failure is a great teacher.
Look at how it is said in engineering that if you don't fail, you don't become an engineer.
Hyper specific. You can be a doctor if you fail, even if you're an engineer. You can't become an engineer. I tried doing both. So first I tried becoming a doctor and I was doing well. But if I ask my 45 doctor friends who are now become doctor, they will say I'm a failure. Because I left. Right? I left because I couldn't stand the idea of staying in one campus for 5.5 years. But then they will not admit that, right? Because they stayed. When I left, I was doing, you know, top 3 in the class. So proudly I can tell them, boss, don't tell them I'm a failure because I was, but I guess that's what they will say. But a good point. If you don't fail, I'll tell you a joke someday about that. Very interesting. Because I was in my engineering, people told me the last 3 semesters to fail. And no matter how much I tried, it's very difficult to fail. Very difficult. Unless you just don't go to the actually, even if you don't go to the exam hall, they'll send you again. You can't just, so you have to go and judge how little to write to fail or how badly to write to fail and all that. Very difficult. Anyway. Anybody else? So in engineering, right? In college. Anybody else? How many of you believe that failure is a great teacher? Raise your hand. Right. So how did this come? I mean, when I ask, when did you hear only one guy is heard in engineering? So how the rest of us figure it out?
When you succeed a little, eventually, then we always look back retrospectively and say, you know, that made me stronger or that made me more robust. And that's when you actually, you learn more by...
No, you're philosophizing. No, I don't know. So like, Amartya Sen told me, India had to be a democracy. And I can source my knowledge to Amartya Sen's book.
Right.
I want you to think, how did you figure, those of you who raised your hand, how did you figure that failure is a great teacher?
So after I finished my engineering, there was no job. So for 6 months or 8 months, I did all odd jobs and all sorts of things. So from that period was the most productive for my learning, because after that I never failed in any interview.
You must go without a job for a few months.
I kept on trying all kind of things,
right,
and gave interviews at places where I was not
planning. And you failed and failed and failed.
Yeah, so that prepared me.
Stay on that thought. I'm going to come back to ask some questions. How many have succeeded in life?
I think it's a process.
No. See here, I'm the student I know. I have to learn from experience, not from what you've read. So if you're saying, like you said, after my graduation, like that any experience, I'm happy to learn.
It is not one.
Oh, multiple? Give me one, the third one.
So, I haven't kept the count, so it's been so many
times.
So again, I'm saying it's very relative. So I'm just saying, so for one of the cases, an engineer too. So in my first year, I ducked in mechanics. That was my
subject. In the first year?
Yeah, it's easy to fail.
So
I disagree with your thought. You said no, that it's very difficult to face.
So someday we'll have to do this.
But that thing got into me so much, I had very consistent good scores beyond that.
So that having failed in mechanics.
Yeah.
It is just which mechanics?
Applied mechanics.
Yeah,
applied mechanics.
Taught you.
Yeah.
On how to get good scores.
It just transformed me.
Transformed.
Because it affected me.
Hold on. Your word is transformation.
Yeah.
Your word is, you said, I learned a lot from failure. I didn't fail afterwards again. That means by this definition, you never tried anything big afterwards. Correct, no?
Yeah.
That's what you said, right?
For failure.
Okay, we'll come to that. Transformation.
That's it. It's a competitive survey. Water polo, and then there was an event which happened. It's just like, so we lost the match, and then introspectively, later on, I realized that there are certain events which are required, certain acts which I, as a captain, failed to do, which could have switched it around. So then next time, whenever it's okay, I'm not doing any more competitive swimming, but still, whenever you're facing a challenge, I try to reconnect and see, okay, what I would have done introspectively here if I failed. So
did you hear about this failure as a great teacher before this event happened or after?
I mean, I didn't hear about it. I was not much into reading at all. I don't read. When I failed, and when my coach told me that maybe you would have done this way, because the tournament is some other place and this was there. So probably then I learned, okay, maybe this. And later on, when I'm facing challenges, when I'm trying to relate it, reconnect it back into that, then I realize, okay, that was a failure, and then that has taught me a lot of things.
Got it. Great teacher. Anybody else? Very quickly,
From my point of view, I'll say for me, I was not good education very well. I was failed. But for me, failure was again the next opportunity to do that thing better.
Why?
Or why separate point of
view? Why? Ego over.
No.
And then?
Actually, I didn't continue. I couldn't continue.
Oh, okay.
So I tried something different.
Okay. So you failed and you tried something different. So what was your learning? Try something different.
Yeah.
And that could have learning from failure.
But if I was passed out of education,
I would have done better. Also, you
failed
in retrospect. It's like Bill Gates, MBA didn't do MBA. Yeah, Acha Vaki, Sony Jani, like that.
Right.
That's why he created Microsoft. So I want to pause for a little now. How many of you have seen utensils at home where we have cooked many things over time? If you have not seen, shame on you. So some utensils, kadai, if you think about it, over time, they develop layers, right? The original layer goes and then develop some other different layers. At some point, notice that how come there are like so many layers, and if somebody starts scraping it, the layers are actually what in business and other things we call conditioning, right? Once you've got sufficient number of layers, if somebody from outside comes, that somebody doesn't even know what is inside. Between below those 3-4 layers, right? Only those who have seen the new kadai from day one, know that this Padai has got four layers and someday I need to scrape it and scrub it and bring it back to original layer. Think about it. Most of us have read about failure being a great teacher, saw somebody, big guru like Bill Gates talking, Colin Powell and others, maybe in other events, we have seen videos, maybe I read some books, maybe some parents have told us. Particularly when we fail at something, to reassure us, don't worry, this is not the end of life, it's a great teacher, learn from failure and then move on and so on. There's two parts to this, if you think about it. The part we will not discuss today is how to stay on course despite failures and setbacks. We will not discuss that today. That's not our topic of today's discussion. What is our topic of today's discussion? Who said learning? Learning, right? Teacher learning. That's all we focus on. So what is this? Perhaps a lot of things we have learned about failure, about success, about many other things are just layers. Form under mind. Somebody tells us something, one layer forms, three people say, somebody in a stage talks about it, another layer forms. And before anything, we have forgotten the color of the kadai, which is the neutral color, and only evaluate the layers. Today I'm going to talk slightly differently, right? I also believe failure is a great teacher, but today we're not discussing is failure a great teacher. Is that a topic? We are comparing, right? We are comparing who is a greater teacher. In fact, I would twist it slightly. In that is, my argument would be, is success a great teacher? My argument would be, is success a great teacher? Which is a bit of a contrasting argument if you think about it, to is failure a great teacher, right? So far I am with you, or I see some physical, Iva, very physical. Am I? Oh, you see, अच्छा आगे चलो देखते हैं भाई. So I have another question, and then I'll share with you. So in the previous company that I worked in, my second corporate delivery job, of which every minute I enjoyed, all of 12 years, right? Like masochism, right? Every day you sleep, you enjoy. Then you sleep more, right? We went through a phase. Right? So even if it was a very large, that time some $16 billion global company when I joined, we were very small. In a market of some 5,000 crore, we were 40 crore. And our biggest company in that business, in a similar business, which is media PR, right? The biggest company was 1,000 crore. And quite often, we'll be called to pitch against the biggest company. How do you do that? You're a 50 crore, the biggest company is 1,000 crore. And many times customers evaluate you based on your size. How do you fight a 1,000 crore company when you're 50? So we are like a typical startup, right? Like 29 people, they're running minus 40% loss, didn't have any VC, right? Well, once in a while we could go to our global board and almost treat them as VC, tell them give us some money to give salaries and all that. But we are fighting, right? We knew someday will this minus 40 will become plus something. But that someday we didn't know when it will be. And those who know how this advertising and media business runs, basically is a B2B. So a Samsung or a Procter & Gamble of the world, they will have a need to advertise. And every 2-3 years, they will go pitch between multiple agencies to give an assignment to somebody for 3-4 years. And usually they'll call three agencies, then the word will spread, then three others will say, sir, why not ask, give us some chance also. The three others will get in. So sometimes I shudder to think, there was a time when we move up a call. So there were pitches where 7 agencies would get called, and we would not. We were the world's largest, huh? Tiny little guy here, but world's largest. So we had to it's our ego problem. How we handle this now? So we said, okay, the first task is how to get called. So somehow figured out how to get called. We get called. So we'll hear about some client will call for a pitch and we go in, sir, why not us? They'll say, boss, we are already calling 8. It doesn't matter. So we used to get in. We used to feel happy, success. Right? Then we used to go during the process of the pitching, we used to go from being number 9 to number 2, like this. And then fail. So there was a period between 2004, I think, about 18 months, during which we made some 39 pitches. And these pitches are tough, right? Because you have to pull people from regular job and they have to work on something that would usually take in real life 3 months, they will take 15 days to do. So it puts a lot of pressure on people, right? But you've got to do, because you've got to win, right? You're trying to win the bread. So imagine 39 pitches in 18 months, almost like one pitch every 15 days, right? So we got our first lesson, that we got very good at fighting, but very poor at winning. So we used to go from the 7, 8, 9 to number 2. So one of my colleagues used to say, we are forever the bridesmaid, never the bride. We are seeing everybody else getting married and we're getting old. Then we took a pause. We said, let's understand what is happening. And I think we had, many of us, we like a bunch of maybe 7-8 people. Many of us have been taught this, failure is a great teacher. So after every time you fail, so we should come and we should huddle like this. We used to get beer and whiskey and chips and all that. We used to drink ourselves silly and we used to write down on the whiteboard what all went wrong. And that list kept getting longer and longer and longer. And we had a practice those days. As the CEO of the company, I had to address the town hall every Monday, at which I only created. Sometimes you get just do wrong things, right? So you also have to give them the bad news. So I have to, you know, stand in front of some 50 people, the hung face, and say, guys, again we failed. You know, we went from 9 to 2, but we failed. Nothing doing, and the clients are idiots. They just don't know what is good for them. You know, they will suffer. You know, all those things which you say, right? And over time, I realized that my speech got better and better. Right? That this part kept getting longer. So we say, yesterday that failure, the previous loss of which we had 12 reasons, now we have 17. We're getting better at understanding why we are failing. I think at 17 at some point went to so long that we stopped writing. Because this is enough. 23, how can you go beyond 23 writing? What can go wrong? We said, no, everything that can go wrong has now gone wrong. It's like sometimes you watch this tough time in Indian cricket, you see the captain getting better and better at the losing speeches, right? So you ask, so-and-so, why did he lose? He said, the outfield was not good, and today we had a failure of the bowlers, and they also played well, and the sun didn't shine properly. And by the way, they say, so next time he has to say something else. So repeated failures makes the leader very good at explaining failure. Then we took a pause. He said, no, something is not just happening, because 39 pitches is like fantastic. And you're just making, you're like a machine that is going out to the battlefield and just shooting, right? Regardless of whether soldiers out there or not. We took a pause. We took a pause and we took just some introspection. We figured what to do, what not to do, and all that. Four things we learned over the next couple of months. Then we applied. So, contrast 18 months to the next 18 months. In the next 18 months, we made 9 pitches. Right? So we brought down 39 to 9. How many did we win?
7,
8. That is good. So one PU. Most of our lessons afterwards came from the 9 and not from 30. This is real life. So first thing we learned going into those 9 is that learn to say no. So instead of fighting with everyone, sir, mereko ek chance de do, we learn to say no. So despite being the tiniest guy, somebody is insignificant, nobody's job will go if they don't call you. So we used to go and tell clients, we believe we are doing a pitch. They say, yeah, we're doing a pitch. Okay. Do you want a chemistry meeting with us? That's me. What is a chemistry meeting? We just want to meet you to understand whether, you know, we like each other, whether, you know, it's like a dating before you marry, right? He says, we're not going to manage yet. We just date you, you know, buy you a lunch or something and talk about things. What is your view of marketing, advertising? Just to see whether we are in sync or not. Some of them said, those who are more arrogant, say, bugger off, we're not even going to call for the pitch. So why do the chemistry meeting, all these parts and all that? It's okay. Next one again, we try. Until one guy said, okay, chemistry meeting. and we should genuinely evaluate whether there is a relationship waiting for us at the end of that discussion or not. As it happened, out of the first four chemistry meetings we did, three we said no, we're not teaching. I was shocked, who are you really cheating, telling Hathi, you know, that I'm not fighting with you. So they said, okay. I think the words break. Right? Then we realized that we got called. And we didn't get called by saying that, sir, humko bhi chance de do. We got called because somebody said, inme kuch to hai. We have to see kya inme. So the fact that we said no, actually, who said NO is, you said NO. Yeah. NO is what?
The next opportunity.
Next opportunity, something like that. So the no created yes for us. We got called. We taught ourselves to say no. Sometimes it was not easy, huh? Because a client is calling, you may have a realistic opportunity of winning a client. And many times in business to business, you think, hey, client, aane do na, aki handle kar lenge. It's like saying, shadi kar lo, baki baat dekhi jayegi. Shadi ek bar ho gaya, to kaam khatam. Unfortunately, here the shadi changes every 3 years. So we realize that if you don't choose your client well, the day you choose, the day you get appointed, is the day your downward slide begins. Because you do not agree on some of the fundamentals of the discipline and learning. That only choose, everybody is in a position to choose. Whether you are a chinti or a hati. Even the chinti can choose. Right? Second thing we learn, and this is something very interesting, and I'll share with you what is the learning from success and what we did as a result of that. So I realized more than anybody else that in the days of that failure, 39 pitches, how much given time? In the 39 pitches day, before even we went to a pitch meeting with a client, where you typically take your PowerPoints and hundreds of them and the clients are speaking like that and you've gone, you know, properly dressed with all perfume and everything, you know. I realized it was the end of it. Before we went to the meeting, my failure speech was ready in my mind. Think about it. Repeated failure and repeated analysis of those 23 points and the fact that they were on a whiteboard all the time for people to see, hard-coded the failure, became a layer in my mind. I could only see the layer. So I was actually preparing for the failure speech even before the first ball had been bowled. How many of you like cricket? You think there are, you may actually remember, this may remind you of some captains. Right? Who first ball has not been bowled there like this. You know, instead of this, and you see this Aussies and all these guys looking like this, and you say, yaar, abhi toh hum log pit nahi wale. Ball has not been bowled. What is that? That is a failure speech. It's just 2 hours advanced. Or, you know, 8 hours advanced. It's not yet happened. But you can see, because you have never left. Sometimes you can see from the body language, from the huddle, from the way people talk, you can see that. So once you realize Aribaba, so the speech was getting written even while the, you know, we are going into the play field. I tried something different without telling my team. Right? One time actually I wrote a success speech. I wrote 5 reasons we won this business. Even before we have gone to the pitch meeting. Right? Everything happened. Lost or won?
Won.
Won. Lost. Right? I said, yaar, abhi koi naya try kiya, winning kaam kiya. Chalo dusra baar karte hain. Because that success speech I was writing properly on a failure speech was only in the mind. I never wrote it, right? So I did it twice, or maybe thrice. Second time I think we won. And then I told people that, you know what, I can't say this is the only thing that got us to win. You all did a hard work and all that, and you know, we were all a very winning team and all that. But one thing I did differently from the past is that I wrote a success speech. Hey, kya boss? I said, huh? Abhi dikha toh na dekho. So we come back from the client and show them. You see, Ari, and as it happens, these are the 5 things we actually did right. And not from the client, when the client, you know, give the result, the news, oh, you guys have won. So we ask typically, why do you think we won? We have this habit of asking them to give us the feedback, right? Bad, good, failed also give feedback, good also, won also give feedback. So one thing we did is just made that a habit. He said, now, before we go to the pitch, we'll write our success speech. Pinpoint with 3 or 4 reasons we will win this business war. And over time, we got better and better and better. Initially, if you wrote 7 reasons, client gave feedback, positive feedback on 3. Over time, we would write 4 reasons, and the client will tell us when we won the exact same 4.
Can you share those?
What are those 4 reasons? Well, those are very technical, because the pitches are technical. Okay. For example, whether we have understood their customers right and are taking pains to explain the behavior of their customer.
Okay.
Before that, we assume. You say, hey client, if you are selling, let's say, biscuit, you know the biscuit customer. Why should I have to, you know, elaborate the biscuit customer to you? Right? So we one reason was client believed you understood our customer. Like that, there are many of the technical things. I can pull out some of them. Well, success features you keep, failure features you, right? Third thing we learn, very interesting. How many of you know how retail stores are designed? You probably know, do you know retail store? Or your wife is more into homes?
Or commercial and residential homes.
So we had one of our units which was into designing retail stores. And one type of skill they employed was something called color science, color scientist. They are color scientists, right? A guy, right? Very fascinating thing. I think we give the name like that.
Lanogaps.
Something like that. So this guy understood, he was a junior guy, but a very smart guy. He understood how people behave in open spaces and how they respond to colors. One time, when he had gone for a pitch meeting and we came back after 15 days or 7 day client told us we have won and we are writing our 5 points, he introduced a point and only he could have. He said, I don't know about your previous meetings, but that meeting I realized all of you are wearing either white or blue. And it hit us hard when people look back without even thinking in many of the previous meetings. Either a dark suit or a slightly darkish shirt, because we're doing every 15 days, right? So we knew, you know, because you don't want to repeat your clothes like in the parties. So we discovered white. What he told us was very simple, and this is only in the context of that business, right? It may not be true for your business. He said, when the client is looking at you, it's like a date you set before marriage, he's thinking about future. Future is all about brightness. Black doesn't give brightness. And we learned something very, very interesting. And repeat it. You need kind of coincidence. Because from there on, we didn't wear anything which is dark blue or black. Even if you wore black, like a jacket, you take it off and keep it there. I think he did another thing. The act of taking off the jacket and keeping on the chair probably communicated to the client that these are friendly, non-stiff, easygoing people. They know they have their jackets, so it's not that they're poor people. But they also know how to, you know, ease up a little bit when you are having a meaningful discussion. Later clients told us that we saw in one guy, we thought you were like us. Because invariably, 9 out of 10 cases, the customer, the clients never came to a room formally dressed in a jacket. Because of their office, usually, right? So they will come a little casual, we'll go to impress, black jacket and sometimes black tie to match and all that, right? But this guy told us, boss, you're too much of dark. That's another thing. We discovered, it's very interesting. We made it institutional. We discovered why. And I could go on giving you some more examples. Argument is this. If you think hard, I'm not going to do this test now because it may take a lot of time, but I can do it individually one-on-one, right? Of course, psychoanalysis. Making you sleep on a couch and close your eyes and going back to your past. I have a friend who also does hypnotherapy. She can take you to past life and all that.
That's dangerous.
If you just think about it. When you failed and when you succeeded, and what we really do, and what failure really teaches, and what success really teaches, right? You realize that failure, logically, teaches us how not to fail. Pause for a moment and think, how different that is from how to succeed. They're not the same. What is the opposite of failure? How many of you believe is success?
It is not failure. Opposite of failure is not failure.
Opposite of failure is inaction.
Right.
Is what you're saying. To fail big, you have to try big. To fail small, you have to try small. To not to fail, try nothing. So I was just giving Jantana the example. If I go out and jump from third floor to ground floor with a goal of surviving, there is a possibility, finite possibility, I will not. Right? That means I have not failed, tried big stuff. But if I don't do anything, I'll survive. And unless there is an external force going on, we are about to be bombed or something, I'll survive sitting here in front of you. So fail, opposite of failure is not success. Unfortunately, our conditioning over years and years of listening to successful people, reading books written by them, actually having paid for it first and then reading, making them even more successful, right? We learn that the opposite of failure is success. And if you don't fail, you have no choice but to succeed. In startup scene, I don't know how many of you have heard, we hear this term and we use it quite often, which can be insulting, but I'll tell you nevertheless. Startup scene in India is populated with what we call the living dead. Start hoge, don't know how to shut down. Biggest problem of Indian startups. That's why Americans are slightly better. They are quite shameless about shutting down. We find it very difficult. Because a lot of ego, a lot of social pressure, I think failure ho gaye. That's a separate discussion, that what is the societal and family pressure on not admitting that you are a failure or you have failed. The fact that there's a difference between the two. I failed in a business versus I am a failure. Our society is still grappling with whether to make a difference between the two or not. That's a separate discussion. But think about it. Failure and success both, and all of us know this, I don't have to preach or teach anything, are outcomes of action. Inaction creates neither success nor failure. Unless there is a dad who's also conspiring to make you successful or something. Or a mom, right? This is a fascinating thing. If failure is such a great teacher, how would you like to be surrounded for a week by only people who have failed? For a whole week. It's a great teacher, right? So you're full of teachers.
No, failure is a teacher, not great people.
Maybe good point. But they represent failure, no? They can talk about failure.
No, nobody wants to hear it.
No. We hear. When Bill Gates says, we hear.
No, we don't.
When successful, no? Think about it. When successful people talk about failure, they're all ears. What are you trying to learn from? Deep down, we are not trying to learn from failure. We are trying to learn from success. We may not admit. What does success teach you?
How to feel good about
it. All of them true. So when failure happens, and I go back to my own example, we wrote down detailed autopsy, postmortem, you know, 23 reasons we failed. I mean, we could have actually written a book, right? Nobody would have bought it probably. Right? We do autopsy. When you fail, how many of you drink? There's a what's the drink of the fail? Drink of failure? When you fail, what kind of booze comes out? Rum? What else?
Whiskey. Yes. Yes.
Sorry?
Yes. Two hard drinks mix.
Hard drinks mix. If you fail as a team, you bring beer out. If you fail individually, we take whiskey out.
Some cases poison.
But the drink of the failure is never champagne.
Yeah.
Think about it. What do you get drunk on faster? Whiskey or champagne?
Whiskey.
You never get drunk on success. It's very easy to get drunk on failure and analyze and cry on each other's shoulder till the night has become dawn and the bye has come to ring the bell. What does it really teach you?
It teaches you what not to do, right?
Absolutely. Good point. Now, from point A, where I am today, or right now, to point B, there are how many ways? Point A to point B, how many ways?
Infinite.
So I can keep failing and keep ticking off, not to do, until, you know, I'm like done. Right? What would be important is try enough, learn enough. When you succeed, diagnose. Do a postmortem. what did I learn? What happened here? What work can I repeat? In our case, we actually use the phrase repeat success until it becomes a habit. Ask some of the successful people, they will tell you success can become a habit. Elements of success can become a habit. Right? Another point. Partly because we don't do enough post-event analysis. So again, go back. Do we analyze failure more or success more?
Failure.
Right? Any of you who's analyzed failure and you think about failed event in your life, you'll realize that even within failure there are some things that work. Right? So at the example I was giving you, going from 9 to 2 and then failing, both was not a failure. Going from 9 to 2 was success. Now the critical thing is that worth learning from or not? Factually, it is. What are we learning from? Failure or success? Take the reverse. Within every success, there is also failure. There are some things which did not work. You try many things, some work, some don't. Those things that work may create success, but still there will be some things which will work. When you do post-event analysis, you also have to learn what did not work. Right? We don't do that enough. What is a better teacher? Okay, I'm not going to compare. So I won't say, to be very honest, I won't say don't learn from failure. I'll just say that think for a moment whether we learn enough from success. Go and Google yourself. You'll know, because I found out a couple of days ago when I was Googling. I found two academic studies, one in US, one in Israel, and by big institutes like MIT, Israel Army, and so on, who have tried to understand the human brain's reaction to failure and success. The MIT study says brain just does not know how to learn from failure. And it's all academic, so I can't even argue with that. So maybe, think about it, maybe all the things we have learned about failure being a great teacher is more philosophical. Maybe to reassure us that when you fail, don't give up too soon. That is good. That even I agree. Correct? The Israeli army, I think, did two match set tests. They took soldiers who had given some tasks, and they took another bunch of soldiers who were also given some tasks. The tasks had failure and success sort of built into them. So both of them failed at some, succeeded at some. To one group of soldiers, I'm boring, is it?
No.
To one? Not much.
Not much.
Good startup behavior. To one group of soldiers, they said, you only discuss what went wrong. And they kept, every 15 days, the task will finish like this, big boss task, no? They'll just discuss what went wrong and, you know, they will be next task. So the other group, they said, you discuss both. Succeed you discuss, fail you discuss. And they did a comparison at the end of it. Who has learned more? Matched group soldiers. So this is how actual research happens. And they proved that the people who are discussing success and failure both learned much more than the other group which did not discuss success. That is one of their learning, that the brain responds to success differently. Who said here something about, I think you said that success makes us happy or something like that. Somebody say here said. Success creates a happy event, right? Something happens in the brain. Feel good. Do human beings, unless you are a masochistic like me, do you want to hear good news or bad news? Right? The brain knows how to respond. Which is why they say how many of you have hired people and currently are running teams with people? Right. So you know probably that there is something called a positive reinforcement. Yeah. When somebody does good, pat on the back. When somebody does not so good, you know, you give some input but ignore. Don't give a negative reinforcement. Because over time, if you do that, either that will go or you become your least productive person. That's the same thing about companies and promoters and startups and businesses and individuals as well. Right? So, I'm going to share a couple of. And everything I've said it earlier, most, you go and analyze all the quotes given by people on failure. right? Brainicode.com or any other code site. Right? There's all these code sites, right? And do your own mental math of how many of those guys were failures versus success in public perception. 100% successful people. So once I go to Everest, I'll say, boss, Everest, you're not a son. Yeah, either say, Uda, either say, Uda, I'm standing here. The guy who's standing at the bottom, he's saying, Hey, sir, they say, yahan se, wahan se, yahan se. So I would say, we'll all need to learn from failure, but not to get carried away that if I fail, I'll become Bill Gates. Sometimes the mind plays tricks on us that failure is not just a stepping stone or a potential stepping stone, but a necessary condition to succeed. Very, very important point to think about. Do we celebrate failure? Or do we tolerate failure? What would you rather do? Do you embrace failure? Or do you embrace success? Right? I'm not saying don't learn from failure. Remember, we can learn from both. The question is, whether learning from failure, that's my question to you, and I'm happy to hear your point of view, is overrated. That's what I do. Overrated. You go and search online, you find, I think, 4:1 proportion of news and other wisdom about learning from failure versus learning from success.
Because the probability here is higher.
Of failing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah, because what you say, multiple right. paths to, you know, single location.
Right.
And hence.
Good point. You say.
And because you know that you have to survive in this.
High. So there are two aspects to this.
Yeah.
What you say. One is, we owe it to ourselves. Particularly if we have success as one of the desired goals.
Right.
To stay on the course. To reassure ourselves that don't drop the ball too soon. Other people who have succeeded also take the responsibility to reassure them. That's a good thing. Right? That's not what we're discussing today. Whether to stay in the course when you fail. Granted, not a problem. Question is, what do we learn from? And what do we learn? What do we learn from failure? What do we learn from success? Right? So that actually almost brings to the end of my conversation. Somebody said, knowing the exact reason why we succeed makes success repeatable. Unfortunately, what happens when you actually succeed? Do you think people learn more from actual real life? What is more difficult to learn from?
Success.
Why?
You don't know why you start believing our own bullshit.
Sorry?
We start believing our own bullshit. We stop it.
So there are three identified reasons now. Global scholars have not done this. First thing is what is called an attribution error. In success, we attribute all the reasons success to ourselves. Right? That's what I think Bill Gates meant when he said it can make you a stupid guy. But when you fail, there are many other, there's the government, there's the rain, and there's all sorts of stuff.
In fact, the book Outlier talks about him that it was more to do with circumstance.
Randomness,
yeah,
absolutely. Circumstances, things not in your control.
Right.
But we don't do that. Smart people do that. The rest of us don't do that. The rest of us say, boss, sab mera hi kaam hai. Correct? Second thing is called overconfidence bias. That once you become successful, it creates a reassurance, which is good. But you know, too much of that is not true, because that's like you become the stepping stone to the next setback.
Right.
Yeah. Unfortunately, many times we explain it away by saying success and setback are like one cycle. Like, and this is very Indian, after night comes day, after setback will come success, then back to night. Very few of us say, nahi, can I make a 5-day long sunlight? He said, that's why in our childhood, I don't know whether you guys heard, whenever we laugh too much at children, my parents would tell me, don't laugh so hard, let me cry. And many of us cried only because they don't.
So that's exactly the reason when I used to cry the thing, now I'll be laughing probably after an hour.
That's, no, honestly, that keeps us on the course. So when we have a setback, if this thing is coded that after setback will come brightness, after dark, we stay the course. We don't need other people to tell us.
Right.
The third reason why people don't learn from success is what is called failure to ask why, which what we discussed before.
Yeah.
We just don't discuss, we just take out the champagne and then move on. Right? We think that the next one is just waiting for us, right?
Somewhere again, you know, Ravi, there is a neutral philosophy that Indians have probably, which is to be neutral to success and failure. Now, for example, you don't take out a sample when you win, neither you cry when you fail. You just be at a distance and be neutral.
The Karmic view of the Indian
this too shall pass.
I have a feeling this whole notion of the living dead in companies is a partly a result of that. That we don't know how to specifically differentiate between success, failure, and that long place in between. So if you are making progress, how many of you have ever seen a psychiatrist? So the operative word for psychiatrist is progress. It's not about cure. The MD, the MS, doctor believes in curing. Psychiatrist believes you are making progress. I think a lot of Indian thing is about the long process between, you know, where you started and where you want to go. And as long as you are surviving. So quite often you meet friends. Hey, so how's life? Maybe it's right. Maybe you're right. That whole fuzzy band of the Milky Way where you somewhere exist, right? You're existing, surviving. You don't know whether to call it a failure or not, or business or an event. You're right. Maybe we need to become better at defining that. Is this a success or is this a failure? Either way, I'll learn because my focus is on learning. It is not about feeling bad or feeling good only. I think maybe we'll become better at that. I think you're right. There is this whole neutral zone.
Well, in your view, like, you know, I agree with him a lot, like, you know, you're taught not to succeed, celebrate successes too much or more on defeats too much and take like a view which is a little aloof or you know, both success and failure are the same kind of thing. What are your views, like, should you go out and embrace success and say that, you know, this is just going to lead to more success and then at the same time say, yes, I have failed, like, actually be passionate about both. What's your view?
So, my view is actually my last point I noted.
I don't think in real life we have got the ability, most of us, to be what is called equanimous. Now, equanimity, ki acha din ho, raat ho, oh, that's a very sage-like quality, sannyas kind of quality, right? I did a course of Vipassana 2 years ago. During the 10 days, I believed in this. Crazy. Right? Kuch ho, din ho, raat ho, baris ho. Be equanimous. I think in real life it's not true. In real life, most of us want to be successful. We define success in different ways. So some of us, success defined by my individual, me alone. To some, it's the family and the relatives. To some, it's the peer group. That definition of success has to be individual, I believe. But having decided, whatever the definition is, I don't think we have the sage-like quality to be equanimous about success and failure. Having said that, I believe in this, but I just give some examples. That there is learning in each, I completely believe. But I also know that not to spend 80% time in learning from failure and only 20% in learning from success. I would do 50-50, 60, but it doesn't matter. Percentage is also immaterial. But I would understand from success, which as we discussed is more difficult to learn from. One of the things I think failure teaches, or failed event teaches, is to have humility, which I think is infinitely useful to become successful. Success rarely teaches humility. Success teaches confidence, assurance, a certain body language, right? It doesn't have to do this, it can be this also, no? It doesn't have to do this. I think that neutral zone, that where you figure for yourself what is success, but develop the humility. I think those of us who don't develop the humility quickly are then called arrogant. So even if you have succeeded, people say, yeah, is aisa success ka kya fayda? Some people will say, yeah, aadmi insaan insaan nahi raha. At least in India they will say. I mean, now he's become some sort of a different creature. And you look around yourself, you'll find such people. And then you don't want to mix with them. They start building a different kind of aura around them that rejects people. Because now in their own mind, even if they're walking amongst peers, they're already on a 6-foot stiletto. You can see them. And not only women, you know.
So when we're talking about, coming back to the point about learning, so can we say that this is about redefining failure and success and whatever that happens?
I would say not to go to redefine. Define the way you want to.
Yeah, so, introspection and then, because a successful event could, the next day could be a failure as well.
Now, so here's what I would say. Five things, if I have to leave some parting thoughts. First of all, to be convinced that we can learn from everything. And therefore, the moment you say that, then failure, you don't compare between failure or success and who's a greater teacher. Right? Which kills my own line today, right? Partly because I didn't take a stance.
I just want to take that point. You know, many of, you know, like my kid, you know, how do you define failure? You know, for example, if I make a face, if she's fallen, my daughter, if she's fallen, if I make a face of, you know, why, oh my god, she's fallen, she starts crying. But if I'm laughing,
right,
she thinks she doesn't get even realize. So I'm saying what defines failure? For the fact is, you know, it's the society which is defining it for you.
Also true, to an extent. But here's the other way of looking at it. Quite often we define success and failure because we don't have a pre-action definition of the goal. Right? That's easy then. Supposing, like in the example I gave, I jumped from third floor to ground floor. My goal is to stay alive. Only then I will know at the end of jumping whether I have been able to successful or have failed in that goal. But supposing I die, there are rest of you all watching me, and there is a thing like learning from other people's failure. Maybe you should have jumped from third to second. Maybe there was a way. Maybe you should have gone, taken the lift to second floor, then jumped to see whether, you know, first floor's may, jumping from first floor keeps alive, then second floor, then third floor. If you had done that thrice, then at least 2 out of 3 times should have been successful. Last time. I think you're right. I think the important thing is, so one is this, I'll just come back. One is having an end goal and then comparing the outcome of the action against that goal. Also, other thing, which is why I think the stepping stone milestone is a big discussion. In most times when you are starting a business, when you are running it, we don't give ourselves mind. We only have one end goal in mind. We are those are the billionaire running time. How do, what are the intermediate milestones? Because then you are measuring yourself in intermediate, against intermediate milestones. Because if I don't do so and so thing in 2 months, coming to milestones, in my company, I know I'm going to divert a little, but I'll digress a little, I'll talk about it anyway. We have now learned, which I'm sure many of you do in your own ways, in dividing the milestones also into input milestone, output milestone, outcome milestone. When we don't differentiate, we get confused. We take input as outcome. Let's say you're in a business where somebody has to, a customer has to buy you something, or buy something from you. Customer giving money is outcome. My website ready is not outcome.
Yep.
Correct? Website developer appointed is not outcome. So now you can see input. So website developer appointed, input. Website ready, output. Somebody comes and clicks and says buy is outcome.
Throughput?
Well, throughput I think is the rate. Right? Output, right? So if you think like that, then I think this whole notion of what is success, what is the end success, what is intermediate success becomes a bit clearer. So I think one of these frameworks we can use. So anyway, just to come back to my five quick points. So first point is, we can and should learn from everything. Second point, and I can go and fight with anybody on this point alone, is that learning from failure is overrated.
Yes.
Overrated. Plain answer. We just endlessly go on talking about learn from failure, learn from failure. Fact is, we know most of us actually don't learn. We just talk about it. Right? We talk about it because it sounds nice and sounds one of the, like book type thing. And in fact, probably you know, when I say learn from failure, I assume that many people think I'm actually successful. So that's what successful guys say. So therefore, sometimes we start wearing a badge called failed entrepreneur. I never wear a badge. Failing is okay. I need to tolerate it. I expect my peers and my society to tolerate it. Keep me encouraged, that's fine. But where do I wear a badge? And anyways, I see a lot of people today who call themselves serial entrepreneur. Unfortunately, good part of the serial that is not spoken about is serial failed entrepreneur. Now, nothing wrong, per se, to think about it. But I think we need to be acutely aware that beyond a point, failure also potentially wastes precious resource. We don't live in a society that our resources are in abundance. whether it is the electricity I take, subsidized, whether it is somebody's place I take, somebody's money I take, my own time. So why I'm okay to tolerate failure, but to glamorize failure, to brag about it, that sort of upsets me a bit. So to go back, I would rather be successful and then say, you know.
Thank you, Bill Gates.
So at this point, I maybe if anybody wants to have a difference of opinion or a different is welcome. Ravi and I have also been debating on this.
One other last point before I finish is that, and this is something we don't do, again from my own experience, is to do a review of outcome. Most of us don't. We just are too busy and then there's somebody else waiting to meet us or talk to us. We say, achha, yes, ho gaya na, wait, chalo, aage chalte hain, aage badho. So success se we say aage badho, failure also we say aage badho, but maybe in a different way. Failure thoda sad bano, fir aage badho. Success, push rao, aage badho. Chalo, aage badho. I think that's the other thing. I think it's a thing we have to sort of believe in ourselves, that we have to do everything I do, project and event, there must be an outcome review. What really happened? And maybe articulate, okay, this is what I learned from failure. That's what I believe. So it's not a rocket science. I'd love to hear your...
It's like what they say, on exam, life is not worth living.
Sorry, sir, who said that?
Socrates. On exam, life is not worth living. Actually, whereas some other smart guy said that how vain is it to sit down and write when you've not stood up and lived. So both are very contrasting. It's always like in a commander.
Yes, I remember I said the argumentative Indian. The truth is this is not the end of this topic. Anybody, you may have a point of view. Somebody else will discuss the topic some other day. But any other point of view? Disagreements particularly?
No, so like according to you, then when you fail, don't do the failure analytics. What do you do?
No. Sorry, I didn't say don't do failure. I said analyze failure.
Yeah, okay.
But
you'll analyze. Then do what?
Two parts. I'm just telling you. So failure, you'll say, what have I learned from failure? That's the main thing. What have I learned? You'll realize and you'll get better and better at this, that your learnings can be divided into things that work and things that do not. Right? Next time you do things that work, you have to repeat. Things that did not, you may avoid it. You may still repeat it if you think that the context was different. Because all failure is not only restricted to you, right? There is something called a context, right? So like if I put my finger into the fire, there will be burning sensation, depending on how much I put into it. So if I'm trying to impress my friends, I can only put maybe half an inch for 3 seconds, right? But if that half an inch becomes like 3 inches and for 3 minutes, then I'm not trying to impress anyone, I'm just trying to burn, right? So I think, and the same thing with success, I think the whole equanimity discussion is recognizing that whatever name you call them by, there are two potential types of outcome. Each outcome must be analyzed to understand what worked, what did not. Because each of them will have something that worked and something that did not.
So then we are back to square one, right?
Yeah.
Like what you were doing. Like after every of those 39, you're putting up on the board and...
What we did not do, not to your point, what we did not do, write down
what
worked.
Okay.
I wish if you had done that, then maybe instead of 39, we would have started going over the fence around 15, 20, because my guess is whatever you could have learned from 39, you would have learned from 15 also. Okay. So other 24 we would have saved. Or we have decided not to go for those 24 and therefore save the time, energy of young, enthusiastic people, many of whom must have got demoralized. Ki yaar, ye company mein kuch nahi hota hai. Khali failure hi failure.
So what we are saying is we miss analyzing our success and we miss taking
out. Can we summarize it that failure as a learning opportunity is overrated and success as a learning opportunity is highly wasted.
Underrated.
Yeah,
no, you're right. Maybe.
Wasted.
Good,
not
wasted.
Wasted.
Good summary. So much, I spoke, I really
worked on it. So, kind of vague question. So, the 39 pitches which you made, and then 9 pitches after that, at the broad level, they were the same thing you were doing. The engagement was different, but same thing you were trying. But there are times when you are trying to launch, which is something new. It has a bit of innovation in it. You cannot learn completely from success and failure of past events. what are your thoughts about, and when you are in that phase, you are about to launch some service or product, which is a bit innovative, there is fear of failure in you.
Right.
Right. And personally, I think that is good. I mean, that phase is good, at least I'm trying something.
Yeah.
But I cannot completely, you know, learn from past events because I'm trying something new.
Absolutely.
Well, what is your thought?
I don't have anything to say other than what you said, honestly. I think the anxiety of succeeding, a lot of people don't realize that, is usually bigger than the fear of failure. Many people are actually anxious of succeeding. There are times when you are going to an exam, right? And you have this mixed feeling. What is mixed feeling? That I may fail, but sometimes the mind doesn't play some tricks. That if I am successful, I may not even know why I became successful. So when we talk about uncertainty in business, I think the uncertainty is for both, right? I may fail, I may succeed. So I would say, going back to what I said, I think usually we put only one goal. So either 0 or 1. Like I told you about jumping from third floor. If you put intermediate goals, right, milestones. Let's say I'm going from here to Pune. I can. There are actually 3 or 4 different roads, right? If I go on one road and psych myself as the only one road and there is a roadblock, I'll wait there for 2 days until the roadblock got clear. But if I knew that there are multiple milestones, once I hit X place, I'll be called to find out that whether the road is clear or not, or maybe there is some sign that says take a diversion. I think intermediate milestones allow us to take diversions when required. And I think startups and running a business is all about taking multiple, being aware of multiple routes. Have the courage to take an alternative route as opposed to sitting on ego. More often than not, our ego does not allow to change course. We psych ourselves, I know how this is going to work. And you know, in my other angel investing role, I hear this from startups all the time. Sir, I know exactly how this is going to work. I would say, boss, that's very difficult. Then I'll find it difficult, and I'm sure most investors will find it difficult to bet on someone who knows exactly how it will work. Because that exact represents what?
So
rigidity.
Correct.
I would rather hear someone saying, I have a broad visibility of how this is going to work. But I'm going to iterate, I'm going to, you know, try and learn as I go. That is a much better approach than knowing exactly.
I mean, if I knew exactly how it's going to work, I'd rather sell that formula and make millions first. That'd be so much easier.
So I agree to you that success teaches a lot, but I wanted to play devil's advocate to this. So, what
you have to advocate, Kanchan? It's laid right behind you. Sorry, yeah.
So according to me, what happens when one fails is one tries a lot of things around to make it a success. Things associated with it, things other than that.
Right.
As compared to when one succeeds, one looks at what caused the success. So when one looks at it, one tries to completely imitate it and do it all over and over again. So though success teaches a lot, according to me, it isn't a great teacher per se. So I'll just give you an example. I have a friend who was in a textile business. He was doing really well at it. And then the market flopped and he went to real estate. And he's doing extremely well at real estate right now. And the thing is, if he wouldn't have failed in textiles, he wouldn't have looked at different avenues and succeeded the real estate thing. So according to me, though success teaches a lot, it teaches you to do the same thing again and again and again, thus it does not teach you anything else about anything around. So I think it does teach you a lot, but it isn't a great teacher per se.
Anybody
else
to answer?
Yeah,
I'm
thinking, you know, it all depends upon what you really want to learn from. So it's about what you want to take away from your success. If what you want to, if what you think you want to learn is that you can just keep doing it again and again.
Right.
And a case in point is, for example, what I've learned in 8 years of my professional experience at Future Group was I invariably took on something that I hadn't done before. And I used common sense and, you know, just put in the hours and, you know, we figured out. And that's what, so we built a lot of stuff which had never been done before. So what I took away was, you know, if you can apply common sense, not let anything get in the way of it, keep it simple, work at it, you can do whatever it takes.
No, but what his argument is also.
No, what he's saying is repetitive. I'm saying.
If you're successful, and what, like Ravi is saying, then you learn from the successes and try to replicate
it. So, here's the answer.
That formula.
So, the point is whether your friend. See, he chose to move into real estate.
Oh, that's just an example.
Okay, so let me just continue with the example. He chose to move into real estate. Had the textile business been successful, he would have continued there. So look at it. So what is he wanting at the end of the day? He was trying to
see. You're associating success with money, which is right. But you always associate teaching with knowledge, right? So when we talk about failure being a good
teacher, this man, okay, he could have not jumped into real estate. He could have probably found, if he was very thorough about, you know, that he wants to continue textile only, he probably would have found some innovative way of being in the sector itself.
According to me, you missed the point. What I'm saying is, if you fail, you learn a lot more as compared to if you succeed. Because if you succeed, you just try to repeat it over and over again.
Sir, hold on. So I think let's grant that you're right. I'm not saying that failure does not teach you more. The important thing is, what does it teach you? More of what? More of what to do or more of what not to do. That's the only thing. And it's all individual perspective. You may not agree, that's fine. I have respect your view. That's the only thing I was trying to do here. It's not that they're not teachers, they're both teachers. One teaches you by and large. Because we focus on those elements. Remember I told you about 23 elements? Unlike what he asked me. If I had also done 23 things that did not work and 5 that did. Because we said in failure also there's things that work. When we define failure as didn't work and success as did work, that's when we go wrong.
Yes.
Right? So we say, okay, this did not work, this did work. If you want to make it more complex, you could say, this did not work in this context. Maybe it will work in another context.
And for the fact, what he defines as success today for a friend, maybe a failure for him, he felt like failing in textile business,
right.
Considering in real estate.
Sorry.
There is some philosophy view on failure and success.
Okay.
In this context, when he is talking about textile and then talking about the
real estate,
and then success and failure, because money earned, that's what we are talking. That's what I understood.
Okay.
Now, to understand in different way, when we go in funeral, and all of a sudden, we think something differently.
Right.
But same time, when we come for a celebration of a birth, we do it. So different time, we have to think differently. That is what the fact is.
Context.
Ravi, I wanted to, you gave an example that you said no to several of your clients, right? I don't know what kind of business was that. If I consider my business, I am at a stage or I am at a level where I don't say no to anybody, while my clients at times say no to me. So how do you ascertain that, you know, this saying no, for me as an, I don't think I qualify for that.
It's not a choice.
Yeah, it's not a choice for me. So
I can't give a direct answer.
I'll share an example on this, relevant one, possibly. At some point in time, we feel we can't say no out of desperation. Not because we don't have a choice.
Right.
We are not trying to exercise our choice, we are not trying to evaluate our choices. There was a time when my business was completely down in the dumps, but we decided to say no to a particular customer, which is one of the largest private bank in India. That would be a huge amount of money for us, for one simple reason, because that would have ensured that we became a slave to that customer, because that they would have been our biggest customer, and we would not have been able to take, because we did not have the bandwidth to take any other customer. We would have become their in-house department, so to say, correct?
I would love to take that customer.
But then I would not. The reason was because, like he said, because I had defined my goal beforehand. My goal was not to become an in-house department of one particular customer and become a slave to him. I didn't want to do that. I wanted 20 different customers, even if they're half their size. Today I do have.
I don't know whether.
So it's very simple, because we had defined it. If we had not defined it, we had said, okay, we are in dubs, we need money, this guy is going to give you a crore, let's go ahead and take it. You can survive for 24 months with this money now. Correct? We would have possibly been happy with that. But we didn't define it that way. We had defined very clearly that this is not what we want. We might pay in dumps, but if we go fight it out, we would still get 50 lakh worth of business to find five different customers. End of 24 months, we take that and run, because we'll quickly deliver, move on to next customer, and we'll grow. We'll be much better off, which we were. So that was a choice that we made. Not that we had a liberty, or I would say, you know, if I take your phrase, that I can't say no to a customer. Anytime you can say no to a customer. Just about if you define your goal and whether this fits into it, this path takes you there or not. I mean, I want to go on a long drive. If that is my goal, I can go to Surat or I can go to Pune. But if I said no, I have to go to Pune, then I can take a path of National Highway or I can take expressway. That's the goal which we define, isn't it?
So to your point, I think first of all, there's a lot of valid concern I find in your question. And I think most startups are faced with this sooner or later. Sometimes the answer may sound philosophical, right? Sometimes, not always. First of all, the answer has to be all for that specific case. There's, I don't think there can be any generalized answer either I can give or he can give, that will apply to all cases. Like sometimes they say, what kind of money you should take from which VC. Sometimes we have taken, put ourselves in a position, for whatever reason, that to survive one day, I need somebody's money. And nobody's willing to give me money except one guy, so I have to take it, right? There are many things we do in business and in, as individuals out of what we call lack of choice. I'll not discard that. Only thing I would think is that all of us have heard this philosophical thing called long-term gain and short-term pain, right? It's not philosophical, it's actually practical.
You must have also heard beggars cannot be choosers.
No, well, if you consider yourself a beggar, because maybe, supposing, let me tell you, let's say I've taken this office in anticipation of a client giving me business. So this office has a certain cost, it has a certain maintenance, etc. Therefore, my cost is X. And then I fix that X and I say, boss, I'm a beggar now, and unless I get a client, how will I, am I going to survive here?
That's true.
But if I say, no, I'm not a beggar. I've got a 2 month notice to give to this guy. I'll go and negotiate with this guy. Then can that 2 months come 15 days? I'll move to another office for, you know, 2 months, 3 months until I get a client. So who's the beggar? My belief, personally, and again, you may not agree with it. Different other people may not agree with it. I believe that I'm never a beggar. Never. Not once. When I'm a beggar, it's the other thing I'm saying. The whole act of telling myself I'm a beggar has already taken the choice out of me. Till the time I keep saying I'm not a beggar, nobody else can prove that I'm a beggar. Now, I can die, but I'm not a beggar, I'll not take rice from one. Possible, right? But I think in business, things are not as hard as that, right? Also, sometimes, I don't know about your particular case, sometimes we put ourselves in a position of no choice because we did not plan before. And that position will come. Therefore, what's the lesson number one there? If you call that event, let's for the moment, let's call that event setback. Setback meaning, today I have no choice. Most of us don't want to do things out of no choice, right? So we call that a setback. The lesson from that, remember we earlier said the focus is on learning. Lesson is, do not put yourself in a position of no choice to the extent possible. That means the better, hopefully I can plan, better, which is why do in business they say cash is king? Because cash is being reserved for that potential day or a rainy day. Every businessman knows I have to preserve something for rainy day. Every CFO knows to create a buffer. Every kid knows to, you know, not break the entire piggy bank, have some hidden somewhere. So I think we'll take our lessons. But I think you're right. There will be a time once in a while, that setback moment, then we'll be forced to do things we didn't want to do, including taking a client desperate. The question is, how many? You could say, I'll make one exception. I need a client, I make one exception to take a client at a less than the term that I want. But if I have to take the second and third and fourth, then actually I'm not learning anything, even from failure.
No, you're right, and I can give you an example of this as well. Currently I run a SaaS business, right? Software as a service business. As you understand, it's a single platform. I host my software, everyone uses it. When we started off, we went to wrong clients. We come from a large corporate background targeting, $250,000 kind of sales. So we went to larger clients and they said, cloud kaun data rakhega, security issue ye wo. Aap aisa karo mujhe mere server pe host ko, software ko hi host karo. It was a choice because the first sale we are going to make, and he's willing to pay money, whereas you know others are only evaluating. So we had to make a choice. We said no to him. We went to the second guy. He said the same thing. He said no to him. We went to the third guy. He said the same thing.
How many times?
And yeah, so then we said, boss, I think we are in wrong business. SaaS nahi chalega internet. Then we came back and said, no, I think, you know, let's not do a knee-jerk reaction. Let's understand. Two things we figured out. One, we were targeting the wrong customer. Mm. Large corporates in India are not ready for SaaS, so why go to them? Right? We changed our target market. We said, we will only target less than 500 employee companies, not more than that. Even if I have an inquiry, I will not go and pitch. Why? Because if we go and pitch, he's going to ask me, he's going to tempt me with a lot of money. We are going to go there. What is wrong with that? Wrong is we'll get money. That's not wrong. The wrong is that why we went into SaaS, we want to scale to 100,000 customers, which we will not be able to scale if we go there. But we still needed money. So we decided, okay, five such clients. And we only take it if we go to Amazon private cloud. Means we set up instance for them. Which means I manage one instance of mine, five more instances I'll manage. I think our bandwidth can take care of that. That gave me good seed capital to start off with, because we took five such customers. We went back to the same guys who had said, we had said no. Today we have only of those five customers who are upwards of 3,000 employee companies. We don't have more than them. All of them are less than 500 employee companies. They gave me my seed capital to start off with. After that, we said no to it because we didn't need it. We had cash flow coming from all the smaller companies which will keep driving. So to take from this point, at some point in time, right, you know, if you're a product company, they say, okay, don't do services, but focus, you defocus. But the fact is, some point in time, you've got to do that. As long as you don't get lured by it, don't get into it, it works. It gives you temporary cash flow, nothing wrong with that. As long as you know when to say no to it.
It's more of the mindset and you're making the choice.
Yeah, so the ultimately the fact remains that you have to first believe that you have a choice. I mean, to be honest, I don't know what the situation is, so I can't give a very generic answer, but I can only share my
experience. Those five clients we said no to were our first clients ever. I doubt we would have said no. Because even if first few clients come at a worse condition than what I would like to, every company needs customer experience, real experience of handling clients, as opposed to just fictitious pricing, fictitious product, no client, right? So I think the context would have decided whether we could say no to or yes. Maybe at that time we were in a position that we could afford to say no. What happened, just to give an example, because we said no to, I would say, 3 out of 4 clients that we had a conversation with, the pressure on our people to be in this continuous pitch process came down. Our current clients became happier because now we had time to focus on the current client. They actually ended up giving us more assignments. So it's not that by not aggressively pitching, we were losing all the money. We got some part of that back from existing clients. And now you can think about what is a more difficult proposition? To get a new client or to make money from the same client? Make money from the same client is just more productive. And clients are happy, then they want to tell other people. So actually that helped us a lot. So it's like saying that I will not fight 10 battles in 10 different fronts because then I'm making myself too vulnerable. While my current clients could have run away. Fortunately, in those days of 39 pitches in 18 months, no current client ran away. They could have. That would have been a bigger setback than trying to win a new client. So I think the context would decide what we do. But I think in general, practical eligibility, you know, overtake, not just philosophy, right?
That's right.
Any other? Have I numbed you enough?
I think there's a lot of food for thought, and of course, like you said, you have different perspectives. So thank you, Ravi, on behalf of everyone. Thank you so much.